wanted to begin with the first sermon anyways. With a special word to mothers, but I think to women in general of our congregation, and to men. But in the day and age when our world seems to assault women from many fronts, over and over again, when a culture tends to stay and to stray away from biblical mandates and biblical norms, usually the first and the most severely to suffer are women and children. And I think we see that in our world today. I think we see it in our world today, but and it's been obviously since the fall that this has been the case. I think by and large it began with Adam when he said, "It was the woman you gave me." And it's funny, but I don't even mean that in jest. I mean, he just starts pointing blame, and he just assigns blame to his wife. Didn't even manage to take responsibility, but I am so thankful for godly mothers on this Mother's Day, but godly women in general. Godly women who recognize that the biblical mandate for womanhood is beautiful, and it's where you best flourish. God has uniquely gifted women in a way that he hasn't men. And I'm not talking chromosomally or anatomically, but in just in the gifting of women to men, the help meet, the complement, that we complement one another, to become one flesh, how special that is. And that's under assault from every avenue. From an agency which does more to unplanned parenthood than anything else, to a culture which says women aren't safe even in restrooms and dressing rooms or prison, God forbid. Where are the men? Where are the men? Stand up and defend women. That's the most godly thing we can do when we stand with God's biblically described and defined roles and purposes. So as we honor mothers, we can do so with lip service, and we can talk about the wonderful ways that you guys have, mothers have blessed culture in general, but the world at large. And we do so better than with just lip service, but with men honoring women in such a way that honors the roles that God has given them, that God has designed them for. And protect women. And do so by protecting life, protecting the uniqueness that is a woman. And that's a special call for us. God has designed men and women, male and female, did he create them, in such a way to complement one another so that we can come in and be united in marriage, of course, but in culture in general. Cultures flourish best when it's based upon the family unit that God first prescribed when there were just two humans to begin with. They didn't even have children, and God said, a man shall leave his mother and father and cling to his wife, singular. And we've done just about the exact opposite in our world today. And I'm thankful for the godly women and mothers that we have in our church. We have ladies who may not even be biological mothers, but who serve children at this church in such a way that they're leading them in the way of the things of the Lord. You may not even have relations here, and you are serving the children here in such a way that I am thankful for. And as long as I'm pastor at Delton Community Church, we will uphold God's standards for family, for marriage, for culture. We'll speak the truth in love. We won't sway. We won't get pushed around. We won't get threatened. Well, we could get threatened, but we're not going to give into it. And we'll accept what comes our way, but we will do so to see God glorified as we honor his word and as we honor his son, who echoed those truths. It wasn't just in Genesis that we find those truths. Jesus himself repeated them. So we know they're pretty important. And so yes, we honor mothers today. And I think a church best honors mothers when we uphold the word as the word of truth and we point to Jesus. And so that's what we'll do with the rest of our time. But I want to, you all, moms, women, grandmothers, great-grandmothers, great-grandmothers coming to the fifth power soon for Nancy, that we will, as men, seek to honor you by upholding God's standard. I think that's the best way that we can show that. So that's sermon number one. Let's close with a word of prayer and then move on to our second service. You guys didn't know we had two services today, did you? You don't get to leave in between them, though. Dear God, we thank you for giving us mothers. Father, you have designed men and women to complement one another. Father, you've also blessed singlehood. Father, we know that there are many hearts here this morning. There are hearts that are even just recently lost moms. And how painful that is, Father. So we ask you to comfort people that are experiencing and remembering mothers who are no longer with them. Father, we also know that there are moms who have lost children, whether in their womb or born. Father, we know the pain is real. And Father, we ask that you give them comfort on a day where we do celebrate moms and maybe their hearts and minds tend to go to those places. Father, give them comfort. Father, we thank you for giving us the gift of moms, for designing that beautiful family unit where husbands and wives meet as complements, where they complement one another, where they serve one another, where they love one another as Christ loved the church. And God, we ask you to give us strength to stand strong and lovingly strong in a world which wants to just rip all of those beautiful gifts and distinctiveness away from our moms. Father, help us as men to be strong in the faith. Not strong in a macho Rambo way, Father, but strong in the faith to serve and to protect those women in our lives. Lord, may we do so all to the glory of you and to your magnificent and glorious Son, Jesus, in whose name we pray. Amen. Sermon number 2, which means you can take next week off. Honestly, when I thought of that, I knew what I was going to hear next. Tom, you're getting too predictable. Sharon just read for us a fantastic passage from the book of Hebrews. The author of Hebrews is trying to help his audience understand or to give them a world analogy, something that they can picture in their mind, an analogy from the world of what heaven is going to be like. And it's a wonderful picture about a city, this heavenly city, this new Jerusalem, this Mount Zion that we can actually approach. It's not this mountain that there's this big, giant, no trespassing zone that even animals that touch the mountain have to be stoned to death because the Holy Lord is there and he's meeting with Moses for 40 days and 40 nights. It's not that mountain, as magnificent and glorious and frightening as that mountain is. It's not a fearful, no trespassing zone that the author Hebrews points us to. Rather, it's a gathering of angels, innumerable angels. You can't even count them. Can you imagine that? I mean, just start with that passage alone, that phrase alone. Innumerable angels in festal gathering. We can count, conceivably, the stars we can see. If we guess at the ones we can't even see. You can count the stars, and there's numbers that vary all over the place from a couple thousand to tens and hundreds of thousands, depending on what the visibility is. But this is a gathering of innumerable angels gathered around this magnificent Mount Zion, and they're in festal gathering. This isn't they're not singing a funeral dirge. This isn't a depressing time. They're in festal gathering. They're gathered around and they're with the perfected saints. Imagine that, the lost loved ones who had faith and trust in Jesus Christ, gathered in with these innumerable angels in festival gathering, and they're perfected, they're free from sin, they're free from the anchors and just the sin of this world, to put it simply. And they're gathered to the perfectly just judge God. And there's no mention of fear. Isn't that great? There's nothing in here about God not being a judge. They come to God as judge, and there's no mention of fear. Why? Because they have been perfected, because they're recipients of the new covenant, the grace afforded by Jesus Christ. And then the author saves what I believe is the best for last. He says that they come to, we're gathered to, this approachable mountain, this city of God, it's Mount Zion, and they come to Jesus, the mediator of the new covenant, whose blood sprinkles us clean. Praise God for that. And the author compares him to his blood to the blood of another man, the first man to also shed his blood, Abel, who was stoned to death by his brother. Good topic for Mother's Day, huh? Come on, Eve, what was your problem? No. Cain kills Abel in a fit of anger, in a fit of selfish pride. And Abel's blood, Genesis 4:10 tells us, God tells us that Abel's blood cries for justice and vengeance from the ground. Abel's blood cries for justice and vengeance, and Jesus' blood sprinkles us clean because the justice and vengeance has been satisfied. Even Abel's blood's cry for justice and vengeance has been satisfied by Jesus' perfect sinless blood, which sprinkles us clean. One man's blood cries for justice, another provides the way for forgiveness, mercy, and blessings untold. And this is all in the author's idea of trying to put together what heaven will be like. I need to give them an earthly analog. It's a city. It's the Mount Zion. He gives them an earthly analog. And actually, one chapter prior to that, the same author, the author of Hebrews, tells us that God's dwelling place is a nation. And he does so after talking about Abraham, where Abraham is going to be the father of many nations ultimately, but through an innumerable nation through Abraham. So he gives them that analogy of what heaven will be like. The author of Hebrews in Hebrews 11:16 also tells us, after talking about Abel, Noah, and Abraham, understanding them as exiles in this world, which means they don't have a homeland, they're in search of a homeland, that they desired a better country, a better nation, the nation of God, the heavenly nation. Paul in 2 Timothy 4:18 relates the kingdom of God, well, the heaven, to the kingdom of God. Writing to his son in the faith, Timothy, he told him that God, the Lord, would rescue him, rescue Paul from evil ultimately, and then, he says, bring me safely into his kingdom. Heaven is described as a kingdom, described as a mountain, described as a city, described as a nation. And in Luke 23:43, one of my favorite verses of the crucifixion, Jesus turns to the forgiven thief and says to him, today you'll be with me where?
Paradise.
I don't know if Paul was in the hearing of that, but he certainly heard about it later, because in 2 Corinthians 12:4, Paul says that he knows a man, speaking really third person about himself, he knows a man who was caught up into paradise, where he was given a vision of what heaven is going to be like. So you have a mountain, a city, a kingdom, a nation, and paradise. And paradise, when we think about paradise, a lot of things come into our minds. I wouldn't doubt it if, as I say the word paradise, maybe you even think of palm trees. Right? Oh, good. Melody. We're right there. Sorry for you having me on my wavelength. It's not fun. But enjoy your stay. It'll be a rocky ride. But in the Greek, paradise has an idea of an enclosed space with an emphasis upon which grows there. It's a fertile ground. That's what paradise means. And so, palm trees, they can grow there. So I don't think we're off base, Melody. But if you think about that, it has an idea of an orchard, or has an idea of an enclosed garden. Garden. Not a garden. Oh, Genesis 3. Restoration of what's going on here. Where God is bringing us is a place of abundance and fertility, and where things grow. And it's a wonderful scene. And in fact, the third time the word paradise is used in the New Testament, and the last time, is in Revelation 2:7, where followers of Christ are granted access to the tree of life, which is in the midst of God's paradise. The very tree that they were excluded from in the garden. The Bible is a beautiful story, unified in its themes throughout all 66 books. It's a tapestry that comes together at the conclusion of Revelation, and we go, wow, Jesus is everywhere. How do you get back into the Garden of Eden for that tree of life when you can't get past the angels who are standing there with flaming swords? Good luck with that. You can, through Jesus. And I love the fact that as the very rare and few humans who have ever been given a true vision of heaven, one, Paul was told not really to talk about it, he just said it's paradise. But as we get these ideas or these analogs of what heaven is, that these authors give us these earthly ideas of what we can kind of compare it to, the city, the mountain, the kingdom, the nation. And then all of a sudden in Revelation we have this gigantic new Jerusalem coming down out of heaven, which I believe it equates to just about like 1,500 miles wide, long, and tall. That's that new Jerusalem given to John in that vision form. And again, you kind of go, I can't picture that very well. Square mileage-wise, it take up roughly half of the U.S. approximately. But then it's also as tall as it is wide and long. That perfect cube. We talked about something last week that's also a perfect cube. Holy of Holies. That Holy of Holies, where that curtain was torn, that we get entrance into that perfect garden of God, which is like a kingdom, a nation, a city, a mountain, where fertility and abundance and awe-inspiring visions, which ultimately stop the mouths of those who get them, bring them to just such heights where they're just in almost at a loss of how to express it, but the Holy Spirit gives them these inspirations to say, city, nation, mountain, garden, paradise of God. When we think about heaven, we have a hard time conceiving of what it will be like. Admittedly so, because the data in Scripture is such that they're analogs. They're things that we can compare them to, and our Lord gives us yet another one. And I love this because in John 14, verses 1 through 7, he relates all of it to, and he anchors it on, the Father. And it gives us why it is so important for us to see that ultimately whose glory is seen and whose display and whose power is ultimately received when we think about this glorious future. Jesus begins his excursus on not letting your hearts be troubled. Again, compare that to the first mountain and compare that to the joy of the text that Sharon read to us from Hebrews 12. But verse 1 of John 14 reads, "Let not your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me," says Jesus. Verse 2, "In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and I will take you to myself, that where I am, you may be also." Oh, yes, comfort. The exact opposite of fear. Verse 4, Jesus continues, "And you know the way to where I am going." You already know. You know. You know the way that I'm going. And then Thomas, verse 5, I love Thomas here. Thomas said to him, "Lord, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way?" Jesus says to him in a very well-known verse, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you had known me, you would have known my Father also. From now on, you do know him and have seen him." Beautiful picture. It's a picture that probably we'll never get fully to the bottom of until we see it with our own spiritual eyes, which I'm actually thankful for. Sometimes previews kill the movie. Like, oh, I know that funny spot, I know that heroic rescue, and oh, there it is, I already knew it was coming. Oh, we have no idea of the grandeur, the splendor, and the glory of God revealed to our eyes, nor the incomprehensible thought of seeing Jesus face to face. Wow. And it all begins with this theme of let not your hearts be troubled. The intent of the heavenly pictures, the city, the nation, the kingdom, the paradise, is to alleviate fear. All other approaches to God were mediated. They were actually fearful. If you actually broke the precise way by which you were to come to God as a priest, you were killed. I present to you Nadab and Abihu, Exhibit 1, as they gave strange fire to God. "We'll just do what we want, God. Come to me. Don't touch the mountain. Don't come into the Holy of Holies, but once a year, one man with a specific way, cleansed, wearing specific clothing, for a specific task, with a specific sacrifice, to be given in a specific way, once a year." And now it's, "Come. Oh, glorious Christ who opened up that way. Let not your hearts be troubled." And these disciples are sitting there thinking, all right, we have heard over and over again that Jesus says he's going to die and then he's going to be raised again. But we seem to kind of forget that he's going to be raised again part. So we keep on every time he says he's going to die, jumping in and pulling a Peter. "No, I'll stand up for you. I'll die for you, Jesus." Let not your hearts be troubled. Literally, you can say, we could actually translate this, stop being troubled. It carries more of a command than a let. but our translators are nice. Stop being troubled. And the your is plural, and I love that. You're going to say, what's so big about the plural there? Well, where's the context of John 14:1? All of John leading up to it. And then specifically, well, how did 13 end? Peter, you are going to deny me 3 times. And then you read, let not your hearts be troubled. You think, if that's singular, he's talking to Peter. But it's plural. He's talking to all of them, all 11, because Judas has left. And don't think for a second that the disciples are going, finally, Judas is gone. Because they thought he was going to buy more food to prepare for the feast. They didn't even know when Jesus says, one of you will betray me. They didn't even all say in unison, it's got to be Judas, the greedy, grubby money taker. As he left the room with the money bag, they thought, he's going to get more food. In fact, as that drama so richly portrayed on Thursday and Good Friday, they had the greater question that we read in the Gospel of Mark, which was, is it I? Every single one of them went through that. Is it I? They weren't saying, it's got to be Peter. I mean, that Peter's so wishy-washy, he jumps up, and yeah, you're the Son of Christ, and all of a sudden he says, no, don't die, and Jesus even said to Peter, get behind me, Satan, it's got to be Peter. It's got to be John, he's the beloved disciple, he's so full of himself. The disciple that Jesus loved rested against Jesus at supper. I mean, John is so full of himself, he's got a lot of pride going on there, so it's got to be John. You don't read that. You read that they said, is it I? In fact, they were so focused on Jesus and so focused on what was about to happen and the confusion in their own minds that they had no ability, I don't think, to think outside of themselves and to accuse their brothers. They were so thinking about Christ that they couldn't think the worst about their brothers in Christ. They gave them the benefit of the doubt. They didn't think the worst about them. That's touching. Oh, for more of that in the church. I mean, that call, as Jesus told them to love one another, and as we talked about last week, actually I think it was 2 weeks ago, but as we talked about how he told them to love one another, he actually told them in verse 35 of 13, that by this all people will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another. That the world should be able to look into the church and say, oh my goodness, they are so following Christ that they love one another, that it's unity, there's not division, there's not strife, there's not gossip, there's not backfighting, there's not assuming the worst of each other. There's that mercy and grace of Christ so richly permeating their very being that it's offered naturally, so much so that the world looks in and says, man, follow Christ. And that's challenging for us. All of us. Here they are. In the midst of this, Jesus to all of them says, let not your hearts be troubled. Your world is going to be rocked. I'm going to be killed before your very eyes in a gruesome way. All of a sudden, I'm going to be raised to new life. Be with you for another 40 days and then be heading back up to heaven, ascending to God's right hand. Imagine that sight. How that must have appeared to them visually. Let not your hearts be troubled. Peter, stop looking at the waves and the storms. Keep your eyes on me. Let not your heart be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. The antidote for letting your heart be troubled is believing in God. Believe also in me. Trust what I'm saying, Jesus is saying. Things are going to get crazy. Peter's going to deny me 3 times. Imagine that. The strong fisherman. The bold one. Let's not also overlook the fact that Jesus unmistakably here makes himself equal to God the Father. And he does so as objects of their faith. No other rabbi would say that. Believe in me. Jesus separates himself from even all the other rabbis with that title and shows himself to be God of very God. That's blasphemy if Jesus is not God, but since he is, it's comforting and it's fear-alleviating faith. It gives authority to his word. It gives authority to his conquest over death and sin that was soon to come. And then to kind of help them think about what was to come, he says in verses 2 and 3, "In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, that where I am, you may be also." Some translations render the word house as mansions, and this actually is a leftover from the Latin. And in about the 4th century, the word house in Latin would be mansio or mansiones, which actually back then meant a villa whereby a traveler could spend the night. So somebody that had a large home with lots of rooms, and a traveler, if they were on their way, could pay for a night's rest, and they could get a night's rest before they moved on to their next step of their trip. A larger building whereby a person could, you know, have their 14,000 square foot home complete with indoor pools, 100-inch televisions, a bowling alley, your own golf course, a private airstrip, and butlers bringing you whatever your heart desires was not in view. Because each one of those things pales in comparison to being with Jesus in his Father's house. Like, if I'm drawn to Jesus because I'm going to have marble pillars in front of this house, you want the marble pillars. You want the gold faucets. You want the T-bone steak. If you have Jesus and macaroni and cheese, you got it all. You got more because you got macaroni and cheese and hot dogs. Think about our youth group menu, sorry. That's what we're drawn to Jesus for, like the visions of heaven, like streets of gold. Do you understand that gold is, you know, the streets are what you walk on. That gold, the thing we value so much now that's so an emblem of purity and worth and wealth and amazing beauty is actually what we pave the streets with so that we can go to the temple to worship, not the temple because there is not one, so we can go and worship Jesus. The point is Jesus. This thing that we wear around our necks and we wear on, as rings on our fingers to simplify the, to signify the beautiful union of husband and wife, that's asphalt in heaven. The point is Jesus. The gates of the city, big gigantic pearls, great. I'm going in to see Jesus. I'm not going to stop at the gates and go, how big was the clam or oyster or whatever it was? I'm going to say, where's Jesus? Like, look at the gold. It's gold. Great. Where's Jesus? So mansions back in the day was villas. And if we are thinking about that in terms of I get to be in this really fancy house with the best Wi-Fi that never goes down and never has a hot, you know, a spot where you can't get good connection, and I get caviar fed to me on palm leaves or whatever rich people do, that's not the point. The point is that you are actually going to be able to stay in a place where as a traveler you would find rest, where you wouldn't have to fear, where you would be safe, where you would be comfortable, where you'd find a meal to prepare you for the next day, where you'd have somebody that has built a home that's welcomed you in as an exile and says, be comfortable, welcome. I have provided this for you. That's the point. It's less a beautiful cliffside humongous home that overlooks a wonderful sunset. It's less of that and more of a Holiday Inn Express because Jesus is there. This sermon is sponsored by Kraft Macaroni and Cheese and Holiday Inn. The point is Jesus. And I love that. It's a dwelling place, a home, a house that we can see and have memories made in because there will be much time that we can spend there, that we get to be comfortable, that we are provided for. In fact, even in Jesus' day, the idea of a house was one where you would have apartments, so to speak, as we would call them today, for your offspring, where they could live and get their family started before they moved on. In fact, if we really want to talk about houses from the first century, many of them had stables attached to them or built above them. Glade Air Fresheners, another sponsor of today's sermon. Jesus is saying, you're going to dwell with me as I am already dwelling with you. As the Holy Spirit indwells you. You being a dwelling place of the Holy Spirit. Now, you get to dwell with me forever in my Father's house. He's prepared rooms for his children to welcome them, to comfort them, to provide them, to give them shelter. I think that's huge because the dwelling place ultimately then is Jesus. And the disciples, I love that all of them kind of get their shot, except for John. I mean, John wrote it, so he kind of Under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, he didn't throw himself under the bus. He's thrown Peter under the bus. He'll later throw Philip under the bus a little bit, but here he's got Thomas in his sights. Not to say Thomas didn't say it, he did. But Thomas utters a question now. Verse 5, Thomas said to him, "Lord, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way?" Thomas, like Peter, abruptly asks Jesus the question that was likely on the minds of the other 10 that were in attendance. They were probably wondering, okay, Jesus just said that he's going to prepare a way. How are we going to get there? He says we're going to know the way, but I can't think of a way. And I want to give Thomas a little bit of credit here, because in John 11, after the death of Jesus' friend Lazarus, Jesus and his disciples are on their way back because Jesus has just been told that Lazarus has died, and by Martha, that had you been here, he wouldn't have died. And Jesus starts talking and leading up to a beautiful teaching on the resurrection and the point of the resurrection. And he's talking to his disciples. Thomas, this beautiful display. I want to just read it from the text. So Jesus in verse 11 of John 11, after saying these things, he said to them, "Our friend Lazarus has fallen asleep, but I go to awaken him." The disciples said to him, "Lord, if he had fallen asleep, he will recover." Verse 13, now Jesus had spoken of his death, but they thought that he meant taking rest and sleep. Think about rest, an idea there. Verse 14, then Jesus said to them plainly, "Lazarus has died, and for your sake I'm glad that I was not there, so that you may believe. But let us also go to him." That's hard to think about that thought. Is Jesus is going into a mourning situation where Mary and Martha are mourning the loss of Lazarus. And Jesus actually says, "I'm glad that he died because you may believe." Believe what? That soon Jesus is going to raise him to life. That Jesus is King over Lord of life and death. Thomas kind of takes it like, okay, we're all got the same fate as Lazarus. We're all going to die. So in verse 16, Thomas called the twins, said to his fellow disciples, "Let us also go that we may die with him. If this is a suicide mission, I'm signing up for it, Lord." That's not giving up of hope. That's dedication and faithfulness. Jesus, I'm with you to the end. If this calls for my death, I'm ready. Thomas gets a bad shake a lot. We sometimes forget John 11 and his amazing stand for who Jesus is. He wasn't despairing of life itself. It wasn't vanquished hope. He was actually prepared to give a powerful expression of his faith, a martyr's death. Of course, we know that didn't happen, so now he's still figuring things out. He's like, okay, we went to Lazarus. Jesus raised him from the dead. Now I believe, but he's still going, what's the way? How? How do we get there? We don't know where you're going. We don't know the way. It wasn't my own death, so what is it, Jesus? What's the way? It wasn't even Peter's proposition of dying to protect Jesus. So what is it? Where is it? When is it? Or maybe the question he didn't ask, who is it? The question that may have been on Thomas's mind, but he didn't voice, was who is the way? He can't think about where. It wasn't at Lazarus' house. Jesus has just said they're not going to die because Peter offered to go defend him to death, and Jesus said no. And the question that maybe we need to think about, because we know each one of us has that day waiting when we will die. Maybe the question we need to think about most is, who is the way? By whom do I stand before God as judge? Hebrews 12 told us. But Hebrews 12 also continues and says, it's by Jesus, the mediator of the new covenant, who sprinkles you clean with his own blood, shed for you. And in short, that's Jesus' answer as he responds to the question that Thomas uttered for the 11. Verse 6, Jesus said to him, "I am the way." To add emphasis to it, he says, "I am the way and the truth and the life. In fact, I'm such the way, no one comes to the Father except through me." The way is personal. It's not a recipe. Isn't that great? The way isn't walk up these stairs on your knees. The way isn't face this direction when you pray. The way isn't give your money and give this much. The way isn't serve in this ministry for this many years and you'll get this sort of future in heaven with him. No, the way is a person, and that person is Jesus Christ. He is the way, the truth, and the life. The way is a person, not a procedure. And our religion is a faith in a person and the ability to have an actual, intimate, personal relationship with that person, who is Jesus the Christ. He's not Uncle Sam on a poster pointing at you saying, I want you, and then you just kind of, okay, I'm with you. No, he's a person. He's not a two-dimensional figure on a wall telling you something. He's a person, living, breathing, and he's as alive today, probably, technically, if you think humanly speaking, he's more alive today than he ever was as a human before his death. Now he's resurrected in his glorified body, the first fruits of the resurrection. He's not dead, he's alive. And you can have relationship with him. You can commune with him. You can talk to him through prayer. Imagine that. He doesn't have to check his voicemail at the end of the day and go, how many calls did I miss from all these people at Dublin Community Church? No, he hears you when you pray. Intercedes for you when you pray, Romans 8 tells us. He mediates for you as the administrator of this new covenant, as the guarantor of this new covenant. And he is the truth because in him no error was found, no lies in either motives, actions, or words were demonstrated since he first formed this earth and came to it as the Savior, the Christ, the Messiah. And he is the life because in him is life. He is the author of life here and now and life to come for eternity. Paul in the letter to the Corinthians, his first letter in our Bible, tells us that death is the opposite of life. The last enemy to be vanquished. Thrown into the pit of hell. And as the way, he is the exclusive way to the Father. The only way. And I love how Jesus, after that amazing truth, as if the disciples' minds, there's no breathing marks, there's no pauses indicated in Scripture. I don't know if Jesus paused there. I hope he'd give him a minute to think about that. There's no ampersand, there's no three dots here telling us that. But as that thought is weighing in their minds that, okay, the way is not something that we have to do, the way is not something that some recipe that we have to follow, something that we have to conjure up, the way is actually a person, and it's Jesus, and we know that because he's true and that in him is life and life everlasting. We saw that with Lazarus. And as they are pondering those thoughts that he is the exclusive way to the Father, he then tells them, and he gives them this kind of quick back and forth. He says in the first part of verse 7, if you had known me, you would have known my Father also. All kind of past tense. If you had. And that might have, they might start thinking, like, you mean we don't? And then he says, from now on, you do know him and have seen him. That as Jesus revealed himself as the exclusive way to the Father, he has then revealed the Father himself to them. That Jesus is just not the bellhop that's going to grab your luggage and bring you in and point you to a room. No, he is revealing the Father to you. So that in Jesus you can see God and live. Moses couldn't even stand with his Birkenstocks on outside the burning bush. He had to get those off. This is holy ground. And that was a burning bush. You get to see Jesus as the full expression of the Father and live in the Father's house that Jesus goes to prepare for us. Praise God for that. The glory of heaven, everything that was excluded in that mountain, that even if a bull were to touch, you'd have to stone that bull to death. Everything that was excluded in the first covenant is now given to you in richness and fullness by Jesus Christ and his precious blood in the new covenant. That you've been sprinkled clean, that you've been brought closer to him, you've been drawn closer to him, and that Jesus actually says, you can know my Father also. And know has a very intimate relationship understanding in Scripture. It's not just on page 2, paragraph 4, section 3, we know that Jesus is equal with God and God is omnipotent. No, we get to know him. We take the truths we learn about God and we get to experience them in our daily lives. Jesus came to reveal the Father's will to the world in living out and embodying the glorious message of salvation, the repentance of sin and the trust in Him that invites people into that heavenly rest never before afforded by that first covenant. I want to close this morning with another picture of heaven. Jesus, our Lord of the Sabbath, gives us amazing rest. And in Hebrews 4, verses 1 through 11, we have another picture of what heaven is. And think about this in the light of Jesus as the way, the truth, the life, the exclusive way to the Father. Hebrews 4, verse 1 begins, "Therefore, while the promise of entering His rest still stands, let us fear lest any of you should seem to have failed to reach it." There are but two options for eternity. There are but two destinations. And the one that leads to rest is exclusively provided by Jesus, the personified way. Verse 2. "Good news came to us just as to them, but the message they heard did not benefit them because they were not united by faith with those who listened. For we who have believed enter that rest as He has said, 'As I swore in my wrath, they shall not enter my rest.' Although His works were finished from the foundation of the world," Jesus, our God, finished working, and now He is in rest. We get to then enter into that rest is ultimately what the picture is there, verse 4. "For He has somewhere spoken of the seventh day in this way, 'And God rested on the seventh day from all His works.' And again in this passage He said, 'They shall not enter my rest.' Verse 6, 'Since therefore it remains for some to enter it, and those who formerly received the good news failed to enter it because of disobedience, again He appoints a certain day, today, saying through David, so long afterward, in the words already quoted, 'Today, if you hear His voice, do not harden your hearts.'" There's no expiration date on that verse. Do not harden your hearts. Repent and trust in the good news offered by Jesus Christ. "May today be the day of salvation," Paul says in 2 Corinthians. Verse 8, "For if Joshua had given them rest, God would have spoken of another day later on. So then, there remains a Sabbath rest for the people of God." There's something yet coming. Verse 10. "For whoever has entered God's rest has also rested from his works as God did from his." Let us, verse 7, "let us therefore strive to enter that rest so that no one may fall by the same sort of disobedience." I'm going to keep going. That's about that 11. "For the word of God is living and active, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing to the division of soul and of spirit, of joints and of marrow, and discerning the thoughts and intentions of the heart. And no creature is hidden from His sight, but all are naked and exposed to the eyes of Him to whom we must give account." There is no sycamore tree under which we can hide that He doesn't see. Juniper tree to call back Elijah. Whatever that tree was that Jonah was hiding under. We are all naked before Him. God knows our hearts. Don't harden your heart. Trust in Him. Repent. Turn and trust in Him. Trust in the Word of God because it's living and active. This isn't a sterile, boring, old document meant to stay in your nightstand and collect dust or put out on your table when the pastor or your Christian friends come over. It's meant to be read. You read it. It reads you. The Holy Spirit uses it. The Holy Spirit works in you. This is living and active. Skyler or Lifeway or CrossFit, they're printing on paper that they buy from probably anybody, and they buy ink. It's living and active because it's not the physical document, it's the truth contained therein and exposed to your hearts that drives you to the cross of Jesus Christ and says, turn and trust in Him. If you can't do it on your own, it's completed and finished by Him. Trust in Him. Enter His rest. Come to His mountain, whereby there is no trespassing sign. Come to His city. Come be a subject of His kingdom. Stop being an exile and come to Him and know that you are actually an ambassador. That you're not staying in this housed for rest because you're trying to find your kingdom. No, you have one and you're an ambassador and you're there to share the good news and to go to all the world and to make disciples. And that is rest, following the will of God. Or start at home. It's never too late to start. A pastor, I've never led in family devotions. Start tonight. You'll screw it up just like we all do. God will use His Word because it's living and active. Pastor, I don't know if I can talk to my grandchild about this. The world's got a really good grip on him. Trust the Word. You're an instrument. In fact, it's not your cleverness or your charisma that's going to win them. It's the truth of God wielded by the Spirit of God on their hearts, calling them to repentance and faith. Pastor, I'm in the schools. Student, teacher, I can't do those sorts of things. In your way, walk with God's purposes. Give opportunity, give voice to them. All my friends, I know. I hear you. That's tough. Be the light. You're not doing it alone. Get the Holy Spirit living inside of you, dwelling with you, and one day you will dwell in His house with His Son for His glory. However it looks, with big giant pearls or gold asphalt, maybe a cardboard box with a manna written on the side, and if I'm with Jesus, I'm happy. His glory and His light that we will dwell in forever, and it's His rest that He grants us by His finished work. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we're so thankful that You didn't leave us a recipe. You didn't leave us a procedure. But Father, You pointed us to a man, the God-man, fully God and fully man, Jesus Christ. Eternal, yet born. Fleshly, yet spiritual. Dead, but alive. Victorious King. Merciful One. The way. Because He is the truth, and in Him is true life. So, Father, we thank You this morning for Jesus Christ. Father, we thank You that we live in a world where that message is about as stark and contrasting as it's ever been. Lord, we know that what's contrasting sticks out. So, Father, as we do stick out, may it be so because we're reflecting the truth and the love and the mercy and the grace that You've shown us. Father, may we in the church, as the world peers in, may the world see a united body seeking to honor You. Father, as we have opportunities to reach out into this community through youth group and through our different ministries, through God Squad, through our own jobs and vocations where You have us, Lord, may we do so as ambassadors, Lord, knowing that we are Yours. And all that because of Jesus Christ. And Father, I hope, only hope and pray that if there's anyone in here this morning, Lord, that hasn't put their trust in You, that You're working on them. The Word is working on their heart. Father, we trust You. We love You. And Lord, we thank You for giving us Jesus. It's in His precious and holy name we pray. Amen.